nature is always to forgive and show mercy. We humbly implore you for your servant Dan, whom you have called to journey to you, and since he hoped and believed in you, grant that he may be led to our true homeland to delight in its everlasting joys. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. We invite Pat and Teresa to come to the sanctuary to proclaim God's word, and we may be seated.
Thank you.
faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way. Thomas said to him, Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Gospel of the Lord. Life Legacy Award. Be grateful for the gift of life. God's the author, and our parents were brought ways. It's something we proclaim and live by not only in election time, but every day of our lives. We're born in this world. Our life begins at conception. We care for that life, we respect that life, we love that life, we help each other along the way until God calls us home from natural death. And as St. Paul tells us as we sang in the opening hymn today, eye is not seen, ear is not heard, but God is ready for those who love Him. Our life on earth leads us to our eternal life in heaven. And heaven is the goal for our living. And St. Paul told us in 2 Peter, for if we believe that Jesus Christ died and rose, so too will God, through Jesus, bring with Him those who have fallen asleep. Therefore, console one another with these words. And we do. We do. Dorothy, you and I spoke on the phone on Monday for quite a while. And you were telling me that Dan died prepared. Isn't that what we all pray for? To be delivered from a sudden, unexpected death. To die prepared. With family around us. And one of the patronal causes of St. Joseph, the patron of our parish, is a happy death. Now, we don't usually put those two words together in ordinary conversation, a happy death. We should. Why is Joseph the patron of a happy death? Well, because the last time we hear Joseph in the scriptures is when Jesus was 12 years old, got lost and found in the temple. When he begins his public life at age 30, no mention of Joseph being crowned. And so we come to the conclusion that he died somewhere before Jesus was 30 years of age. Probably dying at home in the presence of Jesus and Mary. What could you ask for more? To die in the presence of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, with family around, and ready to meet God. You mentioned that he was anointed twice with the holy oils. He went with the sick. I suppose we could say, for God's grace and the sacraments, he split in heaven. Well oiled, well anointed. But that's God's providence. God wants us to go to heaven, enables us to go. For his Son, Jesus Christ, his passion, death, and resurrection. Another thing that you can, which is something that not every family has. He knew he was dying. You all had a chance to say to him what you wanted to say. people have great devotion to St. Therese will tell you that when they pray a particular intention, so often, somewhere along the line, they get a rose. I've heard so many versions of that over the years. Here's another. Came back from the hospital. His silk robe was immortalized. Saints watch over us. We're not alone. We're in a great company. In the cherry box that contains cremains, you told me that Dan made it himself 22 years ago and kept out where you could see it every day. Now, that's not morbid. It just keeps our eyes open. We're all going to die. We're all going to die. Mortality rate for us human beings is still at 100%. But sometimes people want to live like they're the exception. It never happened. We focus on death because we look forward to heaven. That's the gateway. And so I want to live a worthwhile life now, to be ready when the Lord calls me. I don't know when my death is going to occur. You don't know when your death is going to occur. But if we live each day well, with God's grace, we'll be ready whenever that moment comes. Dorothea told me this line. He said, Dan gave his life for me and for Archie. You know that's true. And so even in our tears today, there could be some joy and gratitude. His obituary began. Daniel George Kagan, 85 years of age and a longtime resident of Vermillion, was called home to heaven on Wednesday, October the 9th, 2024, in Mercy Regional Medical Center in Moraine. Jesus kept his promise to Dan that day, Wednesday, the 9th of October. The promises that he made to all of us in today's gospel. But he says, don't let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God. Have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. I will come back and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. This place, eternity, Dan encourages each one of us to remain faithful to the Lord until that day when the Lord calls each one of us. Today we remember Dan and all of our faithful people. Their years with us mark our journeys through life, from birth to death. They're like the milestones, like the mile markers that we see on the highways. The people who've been all around us, who've been with us, maybe are older than we are. They help us to see how far we've come. But we still don't know how far we have yet to go. For our parents, we owe a great deal of debt. We owe to them, through God's gift of genetics, how we look. We owe to them the language that we speak as our mother tongue. Language we spoke at home. In fact, even how we walk, the things that we enjoy, the experiences that we walk up, that we remember, that we never forget. They've significantly made us and shaped us in the persons that we are today. We only seem to outlive our parents because we believe in eternal life, the kingdom of heaven. That even if they had gone before us, like Dan has, they're still with us. We're part of this community of saints, this family, the church. We come to this earth at our worst, we own nothing, and we're born on our own. And we die at our worst. All the things we've accumulated have no value in eternity. We leave them all behind. As someone put it, they've never seen a funeral hearse pulling a U-Haul trailer. We take with us the good that we've done here in this life. And our Savior sets the way. He is the way, the truth, and the life, and the example. He was born poor. The Son of God was born poor as a baby in Bethlehem. And on the cross, he died naked. And at his resurrection, gives us the richness of eternal life, for which we long in this world, and will only be satisfied when we get there. Each of us is a tenant in this life, no matter how long we live in the house that we own. It's not our permanent happiness. Many of us have moved many times in life. We make the home that we live in, that house, into a home. It's not our permanent address. We're given a little bit in God's farm, in God's vineyard, to tend to till that God, our landlord, makes merciful allowances when it comes time for us to pay the rent. Divinely merciful. And all those who have gone before us have shown us something of the goodness of God. That God has put into men and women. It was largely through them that God has been good to us. We give thanks to God for their lives, and with confidence we pray to that same God to give them their eternal. Pope Benedict XVI, what a powerhouse of wisdom, taking his great brain in theology and philosophy and humanities and so forth, and carves out words that maybe we would never put together that way, but we're glad he can. It was asked this question, what will eternal life be like? It's a question we all ask. What will we like on the other side? And he answered, eternal life will be like immersing yourself in the ocean of infinite love, where time, a before and after, no longer exists. Fullness of life and joy. That's what we hope for and expect from our being with Christ. Beautiful words. They aim us in the right direction. There was a Christian man that was dying. A friend of his came to visit him. And dying people don't lie. They have no reason to. Well, they were old friends. And he's seated there next to his dying friend. And he says to him, are you afraid to cross the river of death? With a weak smile, the dying man replied with conviction, my father owns the land on both sides of the river. Why should I be afraid? Here we are face to face with the mystery of death. We stand in his fatherly care. Much of experience along with him. Not be afraid. To live every day with significance and purpose. With God's grace, do your best every day. Then when God calls you, through the grace of Jesus Christ, you will be ready. So why should I be afraid? both sides of the river. Dan and the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you home to the heavenly Jerusalem. May you have eternal rest, happiness, and peace. May all of us, as your family and your friends, take comfort in believing this. acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Dan, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him, the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. remember your servant Dan, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages. We may praise, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. We may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Our communion hymn is number 616, I Have Loved You, number 616.
Mm-hmm. very, very dark day and he's out the window. Or just we keep that time, a little piece of the cloud opened up and the sun shined right on dad and lit up his bed. And then when we got to the end of that verse, it was done. It closed back up. So that's why I walked on my head down right now. Our family wants to thank you for coming today and celebrating with us the life of our man, Papa Daniel. For everyone who prayed for him and us in the past few weeks, your prayers joined with ours and the power we felt from them helped Dad prepare for the journey he had to make. It was comforting to everyone for your support. Our dad had a very interesting and fulfilled life. His beginning on November 6, 1939, started out very humble. His mother, Martha, and father, George Kagan, met, married, and conceived Dad within a few months before George passed away of a sudden illness. Dad never got to meet him. When he was 8 years old, Grandma married Ernestina, who adopted Dad, and that is a grandpa name. Dad grew up in Broadville Heights and graduated from St. Ignatius High School in 1957, which he was very proud of. There he met my uncle Dad, who became his lifelong friend and his eventual brother-in-law. When Dad was 15, the story goes, he needed a ride, and Bud's dad invited him to go with them. He got in the car, and Bud's little 11-year-old sister Dorothy was along for the ride. They didn't know it yet, but that meeting would eventually turn into over a 61-year love story of their own. Dad tells of his first job working at an ice cream shop where he gave Mom a gigantic ice cream cone. A short time later, he was no longer employed. Sorry. When he was little, there were three things Dad wanted to do. Be on boats, be a policeman, and be on planes. He did exactly that. After graduating from St. Ignatius, he joined the Coast Guard as a radio man for 4 years. He moved up to first class with a lot of determination. He has always been proud of his service and it set him up for success for the rest of his life. He joined because he thought he'd stay close to home, while my Uncle Bud joined the Navy thinking he'd see the world. Well, Dad traveled all over the world and Uncle Bud never left stateside. It was also around that time that 17-year-old Dorothy discovered the attraction of a man in uniform. Dad and Mom had to wait 3 years to be married because the Coast Guard kept them busy. It took a few dates and cancellations before they settled on April 20th, 1963 as their wedding date. Mom said she could believe it when she saw the whites of his eyes. Dad was 23 and Mom was 20. A little over a year later, Pat came along and that began a succession of children. Mom lost two children between Pat and me, so when I came into the world, it was with a sigh of relief. I also came with disbelief because there were no girls born in 25 years since the birth of my mother. My grandma wouldn't believe I was a girl until she saw me. Soon after Pat's birth, the Coast Guard ended. Dad, 6 years with the Ohio State Patrol as a dispatcher began. There must have been something again about a man in uniform because within 18 months of my birth, Eric was born. Then a couple years later, Greg. After 6 years with the Ohio State Patrol, Dad became an air traffic controller in Oberlin, which he retired from after 20 years. He worked shifts, and we may not have seen him for a week at a time, or we'd have to be quiet because he was sleeping. He weathered through losing his job after a year at the center and fighting for another year to get it back. The day he got his job back, he had to take time off because Kitty was about to be born. He weathered through the strike in the 1980s and kept his job. They told stories for a few hours, which the present controllers enjoyed. The time with old friends meant a lot to Dad. One of the perks of being a controller was 8 trips in the U.S. and 1 trip overseas a year. He could sit up in the cockpit with the pilots to observe for his job. Because of it, Dad and Mom traveled the world. When they came home, Dad developed pictures of the trip, and we watched them on screen. We got to hear the stories and see the pictures of each trip. These pictures gave us kids an appreciation of our country, along with other countries and their cultures. Our dad was a man of faith, first and foremost. This guided his whole life. The Eucharist and the Mass were central to who he is. His faith guided him to a lifelong fight for the rights of unborn children. He was passionately involved with the Lorain County Right to Life for many years and president for 8 of them. Second to Dad's faith was our mother. Everything of his life centered around his love for her. He took care of her through pregnancies, miscarriages, and illnesses. He gave her laughter and fun. He shared his faith with her. He loved his family with her. Their 5 children, us, 13 grandchildren, and 6 great-grandchildren. And he literally gave her the world. Dad was an avid photographer. If there was an event where he was at, Dad was the one flashing the camera, by the stage, by the altar, by the choir, everywhere. And as I said before, our imaginations were born from his pictures of the places he traveled. Our grandpa Mueller taught Dad about woodworking, and the shop downstairs frequently was the site of many wood creations around the house. The smell of wood chips brings back those memories for me. Dad was also an avid camper. We took a camping trip every year the day after school let out. Mom and Dad revamped the van into a camper, which they fondly called Bubba. They found out-of-the-way parks to camp because they love the peace and quiet nature. We have heard many stories of the bears and other creatures that came their way and have memories of our camping trips, including a skunk crawling into Pat's tent 1 year. And if you know our dad, he had a crazy sense of humor, which, fortunately or unfortunately, he passed on to us. He was the king of the dad jokes, but also the king of building a joke for 5 minutes. We have memories sitting around our grandma's, our grandma Miller and our uncle Paul and Dad telling stories and jokes for hours. Our sides would ache from laughter. There are so many memories I could share, but 84 years worth won't fit into this time frame. So I'll repeat the beginning. My family and I thank you for sharing this day with us. We appreciate the prayers and support for the past few weeks. Please know that the medical staff tried their best, and Dad gave a good fight to heal. But in the end, Dad took him quickly and peacefully with his family around him. We have heard him say many times that when he goes, we should be filled with joy because he's where he wants to be.
Spirit to guide my thoughts, but I don't think the Holy Spirit yard. And the places and things that I've done. I was a raving man for 19 out of the 20 years. Obviously, the first year I was a non-rape. But then I went to school. And I think right then and there, my father and I had a lot in common because he was a raving man. And we used to talk about the cases that I worked. I was the raving man I watched when I got the initial phone call for JFK Jr., which when the lady called and ran at the group down the sector, they had a white phone and it was not tied to the recorder. So when I answered the phone, I just said, "Group, what's all this? Is I'm too sin or Jamie. May I help you?" And I hear on the other end of the line, "I like to report a missing person." So I immediately said, "Well, this is not an emergency line. Can you call back on my emergency line so this phone call can be recorded?" And I hung up on it. Stupid me, didn't take the phone number. And I prayed to God that she called back. And she called back. She called back on the main line, and the officer of the day, all I hear is, "Yeah. Is this JFK Jr.?" And the lady said, "Yes." We talked about that for a long time and how he related to the three different days. His Ohio Patrol days. Then we talked about the flight, the Egypt Air Flight 990 that crashed off in Nantucket. And Dad told me a story about the time that he was sitting 500 miles ago. He was on the West Coast, off of Hawaii. And if anybody knows anything about radio frequencies, skip. My father Morris spoke very faintly. He started coughing. Then he realized that there was a Russian ship in the Atlantic Ocean. And my father, he ended up calling the district in Alameda, California, who called Magnaria. And Langaria sent a ship and a helicopter, I think, an airplane. They found the Russian ship. When they asked the Russian ship, the raven, "Who heard you?" Only one person. And that was my dad. Couldn't believe it until one day I'm on the West Coast and I'm hearing the weather report from the Atlantic area. And I thought of my father. And he was there at the right time, the right place. So Dad, I left seeing the world and was there as a year. I got my love of photography. My videography and art because of you. I know I have other stories to tell as I'm sitting there coming up with all these stories. Dad, I don't know if it's a blessing or a curse, but I did get my sense of humor from you. And one of my jobs, I had a manager and my supervisor came to me and said, "We'd like to offer you full time." And he looked at me and says, "Is there anything that I can get for you?" And immediately, my supervisor says, "Get him a sense of humor." Uh,
Let's stand. Compared to our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother again. May our farewell express our affection for him, and ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully meet again with the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Song of Farewell.